There's a piece of metal in my food. Well, then that must be a physical hazard. But what is a physical hazard? Well, if you want to know about the physical hazards in the food, then stay tuned till the end of this video. Hey, how are you doing today? This is Adib Irshad and you are watching Food Tech Simplified, where I make simple and easy to understand lectures, videos and tutorials for the students of food science and technology every week. So if you want to level up your grades and simplify your studies, then make sure you hit that subscribe button and the bell icon as well so that you don't miss my upcoming videos. Hey, by the way, this is part 4 of the food safety series. If you haven't watched the earlier part 3 and 2 and 1, then make sure you watch those videos. I will link these videos in the description. I have divided this video into 5 different phases. First, I'm going to talk about the common hazards and their sources. Then I will talk about the classification of the physical hazards. Third, I will talk about the risks that are associated with the physical hazards. Number 4, I will talk about the factors that influence, that determine the risk, the size of the risk of the physical hazard. Finally, I will talk about the methods and the ways the physical hazards are prevented from entering into the food. Alright, so let's jump right into today's topic, the physical hazards in the food. Phase 1, common hazards and their sources. One of the hazards that can enter into your food is the glass pieces or the glass fragments. Now, these glass pieces can enter from the fixtures, from the ceilings, from the light bulbs like this one. And what could happen that these bulbs could break down and the glass piece could fall down into the food, and that could lead to an injury to the consumers. The next common hazard is the metal pieces or the metal fragments. Now, the metal pieces and the metal fragments could enter into the food from the equipments or from the jewelry that is worn by the employees in the facility. The metallic pieces or the metallic fragments could also enter from the wires that are used in the food facility. The next common hazard is the wooden pieces or the wooden fragments. Now, the wooden pieces and the fragments could enter from the agricultural fields, and they could enter from the boxes, from the pallets, and from the carton boxes. The fourth common hazard is the plastic pieces. Now, the plastic pieces can enter from the PVC coatings and the PVC pipes, but most of the plastic pieces enter into the food usually from the packaging material that is used for the packaging of the food. The fifth common hazard are the stones or the tiny particle of the stones. Now, the stones can enter into the food from the agricultural fields, or they could also enter from the buildings of the food facility. And now moving on to the phase 2 of this lecture, and that is the classification of the physical hazards. Now, the classification, the physical hazards are classified in 2 subcategories. The first one is the unintentional physical hazards, and the second one is the naturally present physical hazards. The unintentional physical hazards could be the metal pieces, the plastic pieces, the glass pieces, or the wooden pieces that enter into the food during the processing of the food. The second subcategory is also an interesting one, the naturally present physical hazards in the food. Now, the most suitable example for the naturally present physical hazards is the meat and the fish products. Now, let us take an example to simplify this naturally present physical hazards in the food. Now, what could happen? A food business operator is selling off a meat product, and that meat product is completely boneless. He is assuring the consumer that the food is boneless. Now, what could happen during the cutting or the chopping of the meat product? Some kind of bone fragment or some kind of a piece of the bone could enter into the food. Now, on the other hand, the consumer is expecting a food product that is completely free from the bone particles, from the bone fragments. And what could happen that if he chew that meat product, if the bone piece is sharp and pointed and edgy, what could happen that that piece could tear down, could cut down his throat, or could cut his mouth. Moving on to the next phase, the phase 3 of this video, and that is the risks that are associated with the physical hazards. Now, if a consumer intakes a food that is containing a physical hazard like a glass piece or a metal piece, what could happen that it could cut down or tear his mouth, it could cut down his or her throat, and it could cut down his intestines, it can cause internal bleeding in the human body. Now, if a metal piece or glass piece enter into the intestine or into the stomach of a consumer, he or she may have to undergo a surgery to remove that fragment, to remove that piece. Now, this is one of the most important reasons that why we should not take physical hazards lightly. Moving on to the phase 4 of this video, and that is the factors that determine the size of the risk that is associated with the physical hazards. The number one factor that determines the size of the risk that is associated with the physical hazard is the size of the physical hazard. Now, what happens, what is the, there's a basic formula. The greater the size of the physical entity or the physical component in the food, more is the risk associated with that hazard. So that means the size is directly proportional to the risk. The second factor is the physical characteristics of the physical hazard. Now, the physical characteristics could be the hardness or the brittleness or the softness. For example, if you intake a metal piece that is pointed and edgy, the risk associated is more. But if you intake a metal piece that is round, circular, or smooth, the risk is less. The risk is still associated with the hazard, but the risk is comparatively less as compared to a pointed and sharp edged metal piece. The third factor is the type of the consumer or the customer. Now, there are certain categories that are based on the age groups of the consumers. For example, if you and me, for example, 18 to 25 years of age group is consuming a food product and they have a metal piece or metal fragment, then we people have stronger defense system as compared to the infants and the aged people. And if these foods are intake by infants, what could happen? The risk is more, and the risk of the injury is more to the infants and to the aged people whose age is beyond 65 years. And that is why the size of the risk is also determined by the type of consumers that are consuming a specific food product. So now you have an idea about the physical hazards, their classification, and what are the risks, and what are the factors that determine the size of the risk. But what are the ways that these physical hazards can be prevented from entering into your food? The number one approach, the first approach, is to properly follow and to properly maintain the good manufacturing practices, also known as the GMP. Now, there are a ton of the good manufacturing practices that are available and that are mandatory to be followed in a food factory. But, and if I try to enlist all these good manufacturing practices, it will take up a lot of time. So I'll just give you two or three examples so that you can get an insight, a glance, that what are good manufacturing practices. See, good manufacturing practices include the equipments and the machineries that they should be working properly. They must be inspected at the regular intervals, and they must be authorized. Their inspection must be authorized by some regulatory authority. The design of these equipments and these machineries must be proper so that they can be sanitized and cleaned properly. There must be proper lighting inside the facility, inside the food factory, so that the workers can work properly. The pest control must be applied at regular intervals inside the food facility to reduce the amount, to reduce the number of the pests that are present inside the food facility. So these are some of the examples, some of the hints about the good manufacturing practices. If you want to know more about the good manufacturing practices, let me know down in the comments so that I can provide you a different video on GMP. The second approach to prevent the physical hazards from entering into the food is HACCP principle, also known as HACCP. Now, HACCP stands for Hazard Analysis Critical Control Points, and HACCP basically includes the careful monitoring of each and every step that is present in the processing or the production process. Now, the HACCP principle is a very important concept, and that is why I'll make a different video on HACCP. I'm not explaining HACCP in this video. So this was it for today. Let me know down in the comments if you haven't understood any concept or any example. I'll make sure that I reply to each one of your comments, and like this video for sure and subscribe to this channel already if you haven't. Hey, and by the way, happy World Food Day in advance. Thank you, class dismissed.